Okay, good evening, ladies, gentlemen, students, associate members, basically engineers.
Right.
And welcome to the, what is considered by the IESL to be an integral part of your education, knowledge of the B paper, the knowledge of the code of ethics. Okay, how many of you are sitting this paper for the first time or for the second time? A repeat, how many repeats? Was it that difficult? Okay, first time. Okay, basically there are nothing to be scared of the paper because the questions are set on the code of ethics and the disciplinary procedure. So, if you, after you listen to whatever I say and you can take it in, and then if you just go and go over it and do one or two, some of the past papers, I think you have a pretty good chance of passing. And I find that basically the pass rate is much better now than what it was say 5 years ago when I started doing this. So there is always a chance that you should be able to pass the either question one or two. That's all I'm interested in as far as my involvement with this B-paper is concerned, which are the two which deal up with the institution, the code of ethics and the bylaws and the workings of the institution. The other 10 or 11 questions you have are, okay, you have about 8 questions are on general topics and you have to answer 3 only. So if you should be able to pass 1 here and 3 there, it shouldn't be too difficult. Okay, thanks. Before I start on this, about 8-9 would have repeated the exam. The last paper, that was February of this year, I found a lot of people had omitted to answer the second part. I mean, in a sense that you say clause 4, engineers shall perform professional services only in areas of the competence. Now, there are two parts to that in the code of ethics, right? Under clause 4 of the code of ethics, a lot of people only answer the first part, and they forget or they simply think it's not necessary to answer the second part. So out of 25, you are only eligible for say 15 at the most. Because really, we say on a case like this, I would mark 10, 10, and 5 for language, grammar, you know, neatness, etc. So you are losing about 12 to 13 mark just because you don't answer the first one part. Similarly with 1B, clause 7, code of ethics about continuing professional development, again you answer one part and you don't answer the other part about developing your sub or being involved with the institution. The first part is about your CPD and encouraging your subordinates. The second part is about involvement with the institution, and about 80% ignore that. So a very simple question which you can write from, you know, you don't need to have any great knowledge, you can answer, but you just lose marks because you don't seem to understand what is required. But if there are more than 2 clauses, then I will say there are out of the 5 clauses, of which 3 are this and please answer these. You see, now like I think clause 3, there are about 5 clauses, one has about 8. Then I pick a few and say answer these. But things where there are 2 of, is straightforward enough and I expect that you know that. So please be careful. Remember what's available, what the particular clause is about. And I feel sad because you are losing marks unnecessarily. I mean, you could easily have passed maybe, like maybe the very, very other three questions, but that one you get, maybe just get sort of halfway past, just over pass mark or whatever it is, and you, so you miss out on opportunity. Okay. So the getting down to business, I will deal with ethics, the engineering institutions, the code of ethics, because practically every professional body now has a code of ethics. We, all the engineering associations, be the UK ones, Australia, India, Japan, Korea, South Africa, everybody has a code of ethics. You can go to the web, you can find it. And the ISO code of ethics, which is really specific to us here in, as practicing engineers in Sri Lanka, and then professional conduct and disciplinary procedures. Now, why do you think we need disciplinary procedures? Talk. You all are engineers, you all are graduates, you all are, you know, going to be in the top rungs of management and engineering. Why do you need a disciplinary procedure? You tell me. Brown shirt. Yeah, it's sort of, yeah. You look at it, you know, tell me. Yeah, all these have a right input point. Basically, if you do wrong, I mean, you take civil society, if something incorrect happens, there is a need to correct the person. When you are in school, you are, if you do wrong, you will be sent to the headmaster, and those will get back down, they don't like you, but anyhow. So there is always a disciplinary procedure that has to be followed. And it will be like legally, there will be a court of law, an inquiry, police will file action, and you have to defend yourself. So in the event of an engineer violating the code of ethics, the ISL code of ethics, and if that is brought to the notice of the institution, then the institution has to initiate a disciplinary procedure. So, because you can't just, if, just because you, I get a letter or the president gets a letter saying that this man has done something wrong, has taken a bribe, but you can't just penalize him. You have to have evidence. The person who is making the accusation has to provide evidence to say that Mr. X has violated the code of ethics by resorting to some unethical action. So basically it's a very simplified, like going to courts, same sort of process. What is the meaning of ethics? Do you know the meaning of ethics? Somebody tell me. I can't be picking on people from you, but what is ethics? Like to say something? Yes. Ethics is right and knowing what is right and what is wrong. In a sense, very, very simply to do, and then doing what is right and not doing what is wrong. And that's the simplest. It's a discipline of dealing with what is good and bad, with moral duty and with obligation. I mean, this is something you learn from your childhood. From your small days, your parents tell you this, you go to school, you are told this, you go to Dham Pasale or Sunday school, you are told the same thing. So right along, you are, and from small days also there are disciplinary procedures, because sometimes you might get a kane or get whacked by your father or for doing the wrong thing. So sometimes the discipline is unfair, but still is there. So bottom line is that ethics is
the difference between good and bad, right and wrong. And going further than the individual, it is also the principle that govern an individual or group of professionals, for example. And that is why, or practically every professional body, like in Sri Lanka or anywhere in the world, has the code of ethics. The doctors have, the lawyers have, the architects have, the contract surveyors have, engineers have, everybody has. Right. And it is the value structure that guides a person in his dealings with others and with society in general. So the bottom line is, it tells you what you should do, what the correct things you should do, and the incorrect things that you should not do. Any questions up to this point? Anything you want to ask? Please ask, because I only will do this lecture once for you all, unless you come back a second time or a third time. So if you have any question, any doubts, please ask now, because it's not something that you have to be shy about. So why do we need a code of ethics? Why do we need a code of ethics? To define, as you said, acceptable behavior. Promote high standards of practice. Now, as engineers, most of our work revolves around design codes and codes of practice. And as a ethical behavior would be to follow those codes of practice or to design by the standards, say the British or Euro codes or Sri Lankan standards or whatever it is. But there are times when people take shortcuts and they will put less reinforcement, or they will cut down the conductor size from the design conductor size in the electrical installation, and then that leads to problems which can result even in fatality. So a code of ethics is there to help you and to guide you to have maintain high standards of practice as a practicing engineer. Benchmark for self-evaluation, basically you can picture, see your behavior against the code of ethics and see, am I doing the right thing or not. Establish a framework for professional behavior and responsibility is the same thing, right? Basically, it's the guidelines that are given to act in the correct way. This sounds repetitive, but maybe you have to drill it in to the as a vehicle for occupational identity. Now, this means the basic, and this and really the other one, occupational maturity, means that once an organization, an institution is fairly well established and recognized by society, then you have a code of ethics, people will respect you for that. Because then they know that you, the people in that profession, are practicing in the correct way. It doesn't happen always, because people take shortcuts and try to do the wrong thing, but basically that is there. So that you are expected, the public, the society will look at you and say, okay, this institution has a code of ethics. And the members of that institution will follow the guidelines set down by that particular code. Okay, I will just quickly run through some of the codes of ethics of other institutions like the CNE, ICUK, IEEE and American Society of Civil Engineers. You can go to the web and look at any of the codes of ethics of any of the engineering institutions the world over. Go to Australia, go to New Zealand, you can go to Singapore, Malaysia, Canada, anywhere you want, Russia. And they all have codes of ethics, which is essential for them to be accepted by society as being as the people who do the correct thing. There has been a lot of talk about having a code of ethics for politicians, where this is really badly needed. But so far, I don't think anyone has taken the bold step of proposing anything. So all professional, but then they are not, politicians are not professional, so I suppose you can't. But basically, every, even people like, so even the surveyors and even the lesser like apothecaries, and even they have little codes of ethics for their organizations. Okay, this, so the FIANI is really a conglomerate of the European codes of European engineering institutions, and what they have is a common base which all the Germans, the French, the Spanish, the UK up to now, everybody would have followed and will. And the main thing here is that the decisions and action of engineers have a large impact on the environment and on society. That's one. And an engineer must work in the public interest, and we do that in with regards to health, safety and sustainability. So the two most critical things in the FIANI code of ethics, which will apply to all the European countries, is the I would put public interest, because you are working for the public, the concern for health, safety and sustainability, the environment, and the decision and the actions that do not have an adverse effect on society or the environment. And here, for you to achieve that, there are certain key actions that you have to follow. You shall only practice in your relevant competence. Right? Bottom line means that if you are a civil engineer, you don't go and try to do electrical work. You just work in what you know. And if you are a civil engineer and you are specialized in water supply and drainage, you don't go and get involved in structural designs or things like or irrigation. Right? So you have to work in area that you are competent. When we graduate, we have done civil engineering or mechanical or electrical. But as you go up, you start specializing. And that's where you are supposed, when you start practicing, you have to work in new areas that you know. Then you shall not misrepresent your educational qualifications or your professional titles. I think that's quite clear. But when we write CVs, I have found people write and say, we did this. And when you actually, if you talk to the man or if you check back with his either former boss, you will find that he only did half of that. And sometimes even they will say, they have got their MSc when they have not yet got their MSc. They can't say doctor, it's not easy to say doctor because then everybody knows that you are a PhD. But it's very easy to say, you can write and say, I got an MSc, whereas you are not supposed to misrepresent your educational qualifications or professional titles. Then you should provide impartial analysis and avoid conflicts of interest, because sometimes, quite often, as a senior engineer, you are asked to make a decision with regard to a certain problem faced by the contract, with a problem with the contractor and the client, and you as sometimes as a consultant or as the middleman, in the sense, you have to make a decision and you have to be honest when you give your ruling and your give your decision on what the outcome of that problem is. Shall carry out your task to prevent avoidable danger. Right. That means if you can avoid it, you have to avoid, you have to prevent anything dangerous happening to the health and safety, and also prevent avoidable adverse effects on the environment. You shall accept responsibility for the work you do. As an engineer, you are responsible. When you become a chartered engineer, you have the right to sign off and take the responsibility for any document or design or anything you do. And if something goes wrong, you don't turn around and blame your subordinate and say, I gave him to do the job and then you shouldn't have signed it if it was wrong. So you have to take responsibility for anything you do in the engineering field as far as this is concerned. And you shall respect the personal rights of persons or who work with you. That bottom line is, it means that we are not talking of discrimination. There is no caste, creed or religion as far as the engineer is concerned. We are all one. We all work together and we treat society as one. We don't sort of discriminate or be prejudiced because somebody is of another religion or caste or ethnic group or whatever it is. And contribute to public debate. Okay, engineers are very good at contributing to public debate, but in things that you know, right? In fields that they are competent to comment on. And here it just says here that this applies to all the European. I will just take the IC code also, because otherwise we go to all these are very, very, very similar. IC, most of you all are civil engineers, I presume. Or do we have more electrical and mechanical engineers now than civil engineers? You shall do your work with, you discharge your professional duty with integrity, that is, with honesty, and shall behave in relation to all conduct bearing upon the standard reputation of the institution. Basically, you don't do things that will demean the institution. The institution is your parent body, right? And you don't, because the moment anything happens, if you are called up before the CBI or one of those things that are now in force, people say, engineer, he's been caught for bribery, he's taken a bribe, and it's not you, but it's the whole profession that gets besmeared with the tar brush. So you have to be careful not to do things that will not only endanger yourself but endanger the whole institution. But if you have to respect the institution. It's like when you are in school, you have a lot of loyalty to your school, to your college. But similarly, you should have that loyalty to, when you are in campus, you have that loyalty to your faculty, be it Peradeniya or Morotua or wherever it was. But so similarly, the institution, which is your parent body at the peak of your profession, you have to respect it and do things that will not endanger the status or the reputation of the engineering profession. All members shall undertake what they are competent to do. We've already dealt with that. Members shall have full regard for public interest, especially in relation to matter health and safety, and in relation to well-being of future generations, which comes down to sustainability and the environment. So basically, you are repeating what was said in the DFN European Code is also here. Everybody shall be mindful of the environment and not abuse the environment. Now, this was not there. You shall develop your professional skills on a continuing basis. That is CPD.
Right.
You have to continuously keep improving your knowledge. And follow, and also be mindful of the professional development of others, especially your subordinates. You have to see that you take care and you encourage them to improve their competence, knowledge base by following various CBD courses and whatever else is available, both with the institution and outside. Then of course, if some criminal offences, bankruptcy, both are okay, that anyhow will be highlighted in the paper, then the institution can take action. But if you feel like sending a letter to the president saying that so-and-so was arrested and or so-and-so has gone bankrupt, you can always do that. IE, IEEE code of ethics, I will skip this because all these are virtually boiling down to the same thing. American Society of Civil Engineers is also very, very similar to what we have already spoken about. Human welfare. Now, I'll come to the Sri Lanka code of the IESL code of ethics. The first clause says that engineers shall hold paramount the safety, health, welfare of the public and proper utilization of funds in the performance of their duties. It shall take precedence over their responsibility to the profession, to sexual and private interests, employees and other engineers. Basically, all the four engineering codes of ethics that were highlighted earlier have this clause. Because the primary thing is the concern for the public. You are public servants. Now we don't use this term public servant, but technically an engineer serves the public.
Right.
You don't serve individuals. As against the other professions. If you take a doctor, more often than not, it's a one-to-one relationship with the patient. A lawyer is a one-to-one relationship. Architect, by and large, you want a house done, it's a one-to-one relationship. But engineers do things for the community, for society. Whether it's building a road, a bridge, power supply, water supply, storage, whatever it is. You are irrigation. It is for the benefit of that society. So there's a huge difference, which unfortunately people don't give the engineers credit for, that they are serving the public and society as against serving, working for an individual and collecting more money. Engineers shall always uphold the honor and dignity of the profession. Yes, you should always, as I said earlier, you should always act in such a manner that you do not demean or besmirch the status of the institution of engineers Sri Lanka or wherever it is. Engineers shall build a reputation on merit. So basically you have to earn your recognition and your reputation on what you do and by doing it correctly. Not by going having political connections or being related to the boss or whatever it is and getting your promotion. You have to earn that by what you do and by achieving that by your competence and capability. Engineers shall only work in areas of their competence. Everybody has that. And you are expected to work only in areas that you know. You shall work in the interest of your client. Because you are faithful. You are being employed by a person, you have to be faithful to him. You don't go and sell his quotations out to the competitor or whatever it is. You have to be faithful and you work in the interest of your employer. You shall make express opinions in a truthful and objective manner. That's fine. CBD, that's again one of the most critical things, and everybody deals with that. You have to have CBD in place. Right? That's the one way you can improve your capability. I graduated well over 40 years ago from Peradeniya. If I stuck with what I learned then, I would be most probably in home for the ages or whatever it is. But to be continuously in practice, you have to keep abreast with the current trends in engineering. And engineering is not a dead subject. It's continuously advancing. So those of you who in the telecom and IT areas, it's every couple of months things keep changing. Even in electrical, mechanical, every area, there are huge changes. So you have CBD, one of the most important things for your career development. And engineers shall be committed to the needs of sustainable, basically again your concern for the environment, which is reflected in all the, practically every code of ethics has that. Okay, any questions? Anything you want to ask before we proceed from here? I know you're falling asleep, some of you, but then yeah, that's okay. But ask your question now, because otherwise you won't get another opportunity till next year maybe, or 6 months down the line later. No questions. Everything is clear. Okay. Alright, then we will go on to the ISR code of ethics. This is a pretty heavy thing, and then if you want to break now to hour and hour, we spend a little time, we'll actually ask a few questions. Okay, let's bat on.
Okay, clause 1. The engineer shall hold paramount the safety, health and welfare of the public and proper utilization of the funds and other resources in the performance of their professional duties. He shall take precedence over their responsibility to the profession, sexual private interest, employer and to any other and to other engineers.
What it's saying is that basically your main concern is to serve the people, to serve the public, right? That's why I put the people, because this clause 1 deals with how you look after the public, the society, right? And even if what the precedence or the responsibility to the profession, the sexual private interest, employer, sometimes your employer or for some reason you might be told don't do it that way, you know, it's a bit too costly, but you are supposed to do it the correct way, which will safeguard the interest of the public, both from the environmental as well as from the health and the safety aspects. So your primary aim is to look after the well-being of society. Unfortunately, this is not being practiced that very well by some of our professions. I know trade unionism is a very useful tool, and I think it's a pity sometimes that the medical profession seems to be resorting to this more often than not. Every time they have a demand or there's some little problem, because who suffers? It's the poor man. They can't go. The people who can afford can go to a private dispensary or doctor and get themselves treated. The poor man who has to stand for hours in the clinic waiting for a chance to get treated is left high and dry. This happened in the engineering profession also some years ago when the CB struck and there was no power for about 3-4 days, which resulted in a lot of hardship for the public. And again, the hospitals were badly affected because people sabotaged the generators and did all sorts of things that they should have done. So your primary aim as an engineer, whether you are chartered or even before you become a chartered engineer, is to look after the interests of the public. And there are a number of sub-clauses here which okay, one is that when you have to make a statement, if there is a situation, now recently we had these floods and various things happening, explosions and armory is going getting blown up and all sorts of things. If you ask to give a statement, and only if you are competent to give the statement, you should give that statement, then you must tell the truth. Sometimes it may not be palatable, I'll tell you that. And sometimes your organization may not like it, but when technically you are, I think every organization appoints a spokesman
or spokesperson for that organization. So if you are interviewed by the TV or the press or whatever it is, only that person or a select group of people will speak. So as long as, but if you asked, and they also should be, as far as possible, tell the truth, because the whole purpose of, you know, media is to convey the truth to the people, not to convey a cover-up story. Then service to the public. You see, this here again, what we say is to maintain engineering services essential to public welfare, like water supply, electricity, storage, solid waste management. You know, these are essential to the public. A road may have potholes, you can still get around, but if a bridge were to break or to collapse, then you need to get that, do that precedence. Like when the tsunami hit, I think the railway acted in a very laudable and, you know, admirable way when they got the track to the south done in record time and restore the rail services. That is the type of thing that, and everybody from the GMR down to the laborers, everybody worked together. That is the type of thing that people expect from an engineer. Similarly, I think telecom restored, the connection power was restored. So the tsunami was one classic example where the engineering profession came together and restored all services for the public, the general public, to be able to continue with their lives with the minimum inconvenience. Certainly there was inconvenience, but the idea is to minimize it and restore the services. Then you work, as I said earlier, all our work revolves around engineering standards, codes of practice, and you have to follow and work according to those standards. Because if you deviate, you can, the mistake or the deliberate or otherwise can result in a very serious accident. Quite often you hear of buildings catching fire due to an electrical short. More often than not, if you check back, you'll find that the electrical contractor has used undersized conductors. Because between him and the whoever the supervisor was, there's a small deal worked out and they share the difference. Reinforcement bars, same story. So you have to be, as an engineer again, you are expected not to do those things. You are expected to maintain engineering standards were designed, were developed and designed not for fun. They were really designed to ensure that the structure or whatever you do is safe. Safe for the public, safe for the user. And you don't get involved in assignments that result in a conflict of interest. Do you know what I mean by that? What you meant by the conflict of interest? It means that you shouldn't do something that is against your employer or whatever it is. Like for example, if you are now working for a, you're in a government department or in a corporation, or your employer is the client for a project, and there is it's a road, but sometimes we have the bridges, maybe on a design and build basis. So the contractor, now for the Southern Expressway, Southern Bit, the ADB section, the bridges were on a design and build for the contractor. Now, contractor may not have a good designer. They have good practical hands-on people, but they don't have they haven't developed their design office capability. So they can either go to some place like CCB or somewhere and get the thing done, or they will approach the engineer, the client's engineer, and say, can you do this? I will look after you generously. And he will most probably undertake to do that. Now he has to also certify that. He has to approve the design. Now that is a conflict of interest.
But you are doing something which you should not be doing, and which is working against what your employer expects. So you have to be very careful, and this happens quite fairly frequently, not always, but it happens, where a contractor will approach you and say, look, I will give you the, can you do the design for me? Fine. Sometimes in the case of M&E equipment, like the air conditioning plant or pumps or things like that, the supplier or the contractor might come and tell you, look, I have this, my pump is defined, this is the specs, you write these specs into your bid document. Which you shouldn't, because then it's, you are restricting the tendering to only one person. Only he can meet all the specs that are there. And he may not be the best. So the whole purpose of competitive bidding is lost. And finally your client gets something that is not the best. So those are what's meant by conflict of interest. And as engineers, senior, junior, at any level, you should avoid that. Okay? Any questions on these four? Because there are another... I think there are another four equals one itself. So on these four, are there any questions you want to ask? This is the longest of these. And it's the one that, you know, is the most critical.
I have seen some of the specifications where they have specified particular brand, particular supply.
You should, I mean, ideally your specification should be generic. You should not be specifying unless there is a very good reason. Like sometimes, even in the case of medical equipment, where you have to have, you know what you want, what are the features you want, you have to put all that down in your spec. But you should never specify, I want the Exide battery, when, right, I'm being very general, but the simplest form. But you have to give all the requirement, you know what you want for your equipment, for your building, for whatever it is. And you have to give all the specifications which in generic terms which can be used by anyone bidding for that. This is the moment you go and say you have to provide this brand of air conditioning unit. The whole point, you might as well not go for bids, why waste everybody's time? Just go straight to that person and say, right, supply the equipment.
They usually mention that particular brand or incurred.
Yeah, that is not correct, because the moment you say that, you know the whole thing is loaded in favor of that brand.
Very common scenario in construction.
Yeah.
Any contract, it is like that. They clearly specify the IP bidding, sample bidding, and some other products. Even the switches and all, they specify that.
I know. So, this is where we have to. The ISL or somebody has to work with ICTAD and you see, or whoever it is, and get these things corrected, because the whole purpose is that you should not, you know, favor a particular party.
Thing that you have used, okay, if you have a fleet of a particular brand of vehicles or old your road equipment. Then automatically you are confident with that equipment, you are also stocked up and you are okay, you are able to handle that equipment. So you would automatically then go for that. Right. But by and large, the future light fittings and things like that, I know even one of the contracts on the highways, particular specification was drawn up, for indicating various grid standards and usability standards it's obvious that it has to be a European product.
So the first lot that came even with the label of the British manufacturer. And the second consignment that came also with a label but of a totally different quality.
So, you see, there are all sorts of things that happen. So, as an engineer, you have to be fine. Fortunately, the engineer who handled noted that and didn't get bought up by the supplier. But quite often that doesn't happen. So, you end up with a substandard type fitting, which has a bulk, which has much less a lifespan or anything. Then you have your cost of maintenance and becomes high. Yeah, there is certainly, especially in medical equipment, especially the very sophisticated equipment. You see, once a hospital has failed the particular, say, whatever it is, General Electric or Siemens or whatever it is, they will ask for that. Because they have also spent money and sent people for training there and all. So basically, you have faith that it is not going to let you down. So that way, yes. So this is the thing, but you have to use your discretion. By and large, you don't encourage situations where people can, abuse the system by specifying something and then putting in some other. That's good. Anything else? Nice to see that you all are now quietly unwinding. Yeah, we need a very bold engineer, right? You see, if you ask to do something and you feel that is not the correct way to do it, right? And your conviction tells you that is not the correct way, it is injurious to the environment, it can be create problems for the neighborhood, but you are pressurized by your superiors or by politicians to do it in that manner, then you must tell them, look, I don't accept this. And maybe you lose your job at the end of the day. I just said you need a very bold engineer to do this. But overruling matters, and if because by and large you have been overruled in matters pertaining to the health or safety or of the community or the environment, which is quite contrary to what the whole engineering, the ISL code of ethics is about. So, you have to have the guts for finding out your own big time. But technically, this is what the inspector of you, and I know some of these things are not very easy to put into practice when you are alone, you're a young engineer alone, your career is at stake. And worst is case, if it's a politician, you might get assaulted or picked up by a black man or something and taken somewhere, but that's another story. So it just depends on, but you are expected as an engineer, as a chartered engineer, as a member of this institution to abide by the policies that are not harmful to the community. Then, if there are issues of recent, with all these floods and various overflowing and things exploding, I think if you are asked to give an opinion, give your opinion and you can advise the community also or the authorities how to do the thing proper, do a job properly or without causing any disruption to the public life of the community.
whistleblowing is a rather questionable action. You know what whistleblowing is? I know policemen are blowing whistles every day at the junction, but that's not whistleblowing. What is whistleblowing? You know? Whistleblowing basically is sneaking. You know, when you are in school, when you go and sneak that, you can tell the teacher, that's what I saw him robbing that person's ruler or eraser, you are sneaking, right? And it is looked down upon by say your classmates. But what they are now advocating, here whistleblowing is one way of controlling this. If you know an engineer or a professional is doing something incorrect, then it is your duty to go and advise the authority. Firstly, you should tell him, try to speak to him and, you know, try to tell him that, look, this is not the way to do things, this is not done, you know. But if he persists in doing it, then you are supposed to inform the authorities with the necessary information. And, what I have right here, I think just before the last time I did the lecture, that was over 6-7 months ago, is the chartered accountants. They brought in whistleblowing as one of the key controls for curbing financial misdemeanors and fraud. So it's becoming an accepted thing now. In those days, you were sneak me the kelang, you know, and that type of thing, you know, you are looked down by your friends and everybody. But now this is becoming professionally, this is becoming a done thing. So whistleblowing, I suppose it comes from like the referee blows a whistle when he says error, he sees an error on football or rugby field, so he blows a whistle, and that's where the whistleblowing term comes in relation to picking up a fault. Interesting. Dishonesty, yes, any professional, anybody should not be dishonest. I mean, that's what you have been told. And if there are issues, you see, rather than manufacturing, resorting to extreme, ideally, there you should start a dialogue where you can talk with the people concerned, with your bosses, or with anyone who you find is not doing the correct thing, and maintain, try to, instead of going, say, for arbitration, you try to mediate, you talk and you have a dialogue, start a dialogue and try to resolve issues rather than, you know, going bang into the thing and, you know, ending up with the worst case scenario. This is what KBD, these are chartered accountants. Incorporate whistleblowing into his code of ethics. So we are ISL, or we are head of the accountants, and we brought this in so many years ago. That it really what audit firms who are checking your accounts to, you know, whistleblow as it were, if they find anything unusual. So that's clause 1. Any questions on clause 1? It has lots of interesting features, I think 8 or 9 features there, which can be, if I go to clause 2, anything you want to ask on clause 1? Okay, clause 2 talks of the honor of the profession. As I said, you don't do anything that will besmirch the reputation of the institution. You uphold the honor, the integrity and the dignity of the engineering profession.
So dishonesty is one thing, because the moment you are if you are dishonest and you are found out, people say that engineer took a bribe, that engineer did this, and the engineering profession gets besmirched. So as far as possible, do not do anything dishonest or fraudulent, because sooner or later you will get caught. And now with there now with whistleblowing also in the process, somebody is going to blow the whistle and you will show the yellow card or the red card, one way or the other. Do not use association with other persons to hide unethical practices. This happens quite, this sounds very simple, but what really means is that quite often we run to people we know, people in power, to hide anything incorrect that we do. We, the boss, the politician, whatever it is, and we try to sort of cover up things by using our association with people who have some say in our organization or in our profession. So what he says, don't do that, don't go to use associations or your relationships with others to hide anything incorrect that you do. Here he says, of course, do not continue partnership with anyone who has been removed from the ISL. Basically, it means that if you have, this is a, well, it's not a very clear thing, but it means that if you have a company, for example, Fernando and Pereira, and you say Fernando and Pereira chartered engineers, contractors, or a, if unfortunately Mr. Fernando is stuck off the roll for some disciplinary action by the ISL, then you cannot continue to say Pereira and Fernando chartered engineers. Then you have to become Pereira only, or make it Pereira and Sons, or whatever it is. Right? So it means that you don't continue as an association with a person who has been taken off the roll of the ISL. This, I think when they say taken off the role, it means taken off the role for any misconduct by like fraud or anything, any major crime. Not because you haven't paid your subscriptions for about 3 years and you're taken off the role. I don't think that's a major crime, but basically it would be best to avoid any association in that respect. Okay, that was clause 2. Any questions about clause 2? Shall I state forward? There's nothing. Own achievements. Yeah, basically don't resort to bribery in any form. I think political contributions, every firm I think is doing that. And they not only for one, they look at both sides, so that they are insurance, it's an insurance policy. But basically you have to rise up, like I said, because of your own capability, your own merits. Right? And you should not go to relations and people who are in positions of power to get a promotion, for example. But you should be on your own evaluation, you should be able to secure that position. And also your subordinates, right? You should somehow or other see that they are also paid, for example, and they are respected and paid according to their capabilities and their quantum. I know in government service this is very difficult because you have fixed salary scales. I think they still have it that way. Really. In government service you still have fixed salary scales. Grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 1, whatever it is.
That is, so that you, whatever you work or not, you get a fixed amount each year. Whereas in the private sector, a lot depends on your performance. So this is more relevant in a way to the private sector, where you know you can go up. And I know people who have taken, sent bouquets of flowers to the director's wives or a box of chocolates for her birthday, so to curry favor, so that when his appraisal comes around, she'll put in a good word for him. This happens, this is human nature. Undercutting is a famous Sri Lankan pastime. Something that you shouldn't be doing. If one of your colleagues gets the job because he's more deserving than you, you don't go and sneak about him and you put a kalapatra and you know, try to cut, undercut the guy. If you had the same capabilities and competences and on your merit, you would have got that job. But unfortunately you didn't. And I mean, basically, I think maybe other countries also this happens, but we are famous for sending anonymous. You will have a kalapatra, some poster will come out somewhere, there will be, nobody will say that they did it. They will put up some rather spurious notice, or the papers will be sent around. You know, writing all sorts of nasty things about the poor guy who got that job. Then misrepresentation of your capability, your qualification and your experience. We spoke about that. Again, it's something you don't do. And this has become serious to the point where ADB, World Bank, JICA, the major donors who are funding a lot of the projects, if they find that there has been a misrepresentation in your qualifications or experience, especially in the case of the senior, like the team leader, the specialist structural engineer, or the highway design engineer, the water supply and treatment, treatment plant specialist, they will debar you, and that firm will also be struck off for that tender. They are taking a very, very serious view of this now, because this has become, you know, fairly common. People give wrong qualifications, wrong experience, because they will say that you must have, say, 10 years experience as a charter, of which, say, 8 years should be after the charter, and of which 5 should be in the field of highway design engineering. So sometimes they don't, you may have only 3 years, so you will add another 2 years and put it in there. So, but if they check and they find that you have given a false declaration, then you are in trouble. Not only you, that whole company will be struck off for that particular tender. And if they find it happens with regard to that particular company in more than one occasion, they might be blacklisted for 5 years or something like that. So you have to be very careful not to give false information. Malicious talk, this is another one of our pet topics. Basically, if somebody gets it, we go and spread also the rumors saying this guy did this, that and the other thing, and therefore he bribed this one, he ran out with, he went out with that man's wife. Sri Lanka is famous for this. So basically, if you don't get a job, it's because you are not competent or you are not capable of getting it, and not because of somebody's other person's actions. Connections, again, this we've been talking about this. Don't use your connections with people, your relatives or your friends of yours, or your parents' friends who are with senior positions or in strong political positions. You go and on your own base merit, you get the job or you get the tender, not by, you know, pulling strings through various people with connections. Modesty, don't go and boast about how good you are. Let your boss and the public decide how good an engineer you are. Engineers generally do not advertise themselves, but there are cases, you know, where people have been singing their praises, especially to politicians, with hope of going up in the ladder. And always acknowledge the work of your team, your subordinates. You see, now, as I said, engineering is not a one-man show. It's a team effort, right? If you are building a road, if you are building a power plant, there's a team effort in this. So, and this is again to come back to this. At one of the openings of some years ago of a road, ADP or JICA funded road, the senior engineer got hold of the minister of there and was telling him all about it. Everything that was done and that he did everything. The fact that there were highway design, you know, structural engineers for the bridges, drainage, everything. Those fellows are in the corner, the junior fellows are all in the corner there, ignored totally. Now that is what we shouldn't have. We should have introduced them and said, this is the team. This is the team that did this job. Because they are also part of that. So always acknowledge the work of your subordinates or your team members. Because as I said, engineering is not a one-man show. It's not like a, you know, one-on-one. It's always a team thing for the community. Now, here again, there are about 6-7 sub-clauses in clauses. Now, here, if I were to set a question on this, I would either give the pick 3 or 4 of these and say, okay, comment on these, right? But like, rather, like two, I would expect that you know those two. I won't go to say like this and this. So, I mean, I don't expect you to remember all 8. You know, people have been having their mind to be worrying about this, but I just say, okay, malicious talk, you know, things that are contrary to clause 3 or the getting of securing something on your own merit is these. And please give your viewpoints or comment on these so that you have something to take off from. Again, this is what we have been talking. You are specialized in one particular field of engineering. Do practice in that. Your competence is there. And don't go into other fields. There was a time when a chartered engineer could sign anything, be it a house or electrical or anything, a chartered engineer could sign. But now things are very specialized. I think the local authorities, NISF does this, they grade structural engineers who can do low-rise buildings, anyone can sign. Any civil engineer can sign. Mid-rise, okay, what, up to 10 floors already, so many people. And if it is high-rise, you have to have a lot more experience and qualifications. Electrical, the CB also does the same thing. They register engineers who can sign off a internal wiring of a or the circuits of a bungalow or a office block or a factory before they give the connections. So that way they safeguard against incorrectly done job. But having said that, also there were cases this happened with the electrical, somebody gave signed off a false declaration, and finally when something happened in the house and they checked up, they found that the cables were not to the correct size, the conductor, and that man was removed off the CB. Of course nothing happened, they just take one off that role, but it's not that you're prosecuted in Sri Lanka, the laws are not that strong to do a thing like that. Yeah, you don't sign anything unless you are sure of what you are signing. So you must be honest again when you sign any document, any design. If it has, and especially you don't sign if it has not been done under your control or supervision. Any questions on this? Loyalty, again, you must be loyal to your employer. We spoke of conflicts of interest, you avoid, what is basically saying, you avoid conflicts of interest. Then if you are in the position of having to decide or do a ruling on a particular situation that has arisen between the client and the contractor, be neutral. You should not be biased one way or the other, which means that you don't accept bribes from the contractor or you don't take pressure from the client. Because sometimes you are the consultant and you are really the middleman, but you are employed by the client, but you have to be fair, honest enough to say that, look, this is the actual situation. And you don't accept any money, any compensation, financial or otherwise, from more than 140% services. That's the same thing like what I said, like if you, somebody comes, you are employed by your boss, and then the contractor comes and says you do the design, so you get paid by him, you get paid by the boss, and at the end of the day, that's because what you accept may not be the best option for your employer. Integrity, it again means working with honesty. You don't ask or you don't accept valuable considerations. Again, nowadays people sometimes may not give money, they will offer you trips, a holiday to Singapore or a trip to somewhere else, and I think this happens in some professions, it's a big deal, where even the families are taken on holidays. So basically, because then you are under obligation to that particular party, that particular organization that gives you this handout. Bribery, the bribery is something that is not to be is not acceptable. Conviction, yes, you think that plan A is wrong but plan B is the right thing, you must convince your boss that okay, plan B is what we should do. Confidentiality, this is another area that I think effects comes up always, because when you are as a senior engineer, you know the figures of the company, you know the quotations, the various aspects that come into the preparation of a bid. And sometimes the competitor might approach you and try to get that information from you by offering you a good handout. So you must always guard against that, because you are being entrusted by your boss to do the job and to prepare the quotation, sometimes you may do it, you know, two or three of you all work together. But basically, that has to be confidential. That information is for your company and that only, not to be given to the competitor. Integrity again is honesty, and you don't seal plans, and you don't anything that will upset the balance, where as far as the environmental or health and safety of the public are concerned. And that's what we say here is that if you see there is some deviation from the standard to save cost or whatever it is, and your employer or your boss insist on that, you have to refuse and say that you cannot make this change, because that will endanger the safety or the environment of the community. Well, you should always be truthful, and like we said earlier, anytime you have to make a statement or give a report, be honest in what you say, be precise, knowledgeable, and give the facts. Give the facts. And you don't undertake this thing unless you have the competence to do this, unless you are thorough with the subject. Then only can you talk and you make a statement on the whatever the issue is. And basically, this again comes back to that, say that be honest in what you say. It basically say, so generally, people don't take any money or don't take any other financial benefits for and change your thinking to fall in line with what somebody else wants. CPD, this is one of the most important things in your career as an engineer. How many of you are following CPD courses at ISL or elsewhere? Nobody. Pathetic few. So tell me more. Because the CPD, now we all have people that graduated fairly recently, most probably. But still, like I said, the profession is always developing, knowledge is always on the move. So, and this is where the CPD courses help you to keep abreast with what's happening. It may be in fields of engineering, it may be even in, now if, as you go up the ladder, you get involved more in management, in finance, in HR matters, and you need to also follow up on things like that. Easy route is to go and do an MBA which covers everything. But it's not just a question of acquiring a qualification which you can add after your name. It's a question of being able to practice what you learn. And that is what is important. So lifelong learning is the most important. We are studying or we are learning, as I say, from birth to the grave, right? Whatever it is, it's always good to keep abreast, to read up on things. You don't need to go and start, you know, doing major calculations and things like that. But you keep abreast, you read up on the latest developments, latest technology, and how it is applied to day-to-day situations. And you must always encourage your juniors also to go and follow CPD. ISL has a whole lot of CPD courses. And I think you should take advantage of this opportunity because they are relatively cheap courses. And quite often I think the companies or the organizations, the authorities will fund the full or partially. So always follow and go for CPD and also try to and encourage your subordinates, your juniors to follow these. I think the ISL, if you have more than say two or three people, they give you a rebate also on the fees. So it's always, and it's worth it because you learn something new always. And get involved with the ISL. A lot of people come here up to the point of getting their charter. And we have so many things, sectional committees and so many other things that are happening in the ISL, but we can't have fine people for that. You find the same old people recurring year in, year out in various things. So we need young blood, we need young people to come in and get involved in the ISL. Now all the sectional committees are there. And there are other, even the standing committees. Standing committees, I don't know whether they, it was only, you had to be chartered engineer, but I think they were trying to open it to associate members also. So, whatever it is, but you can get involved in the various sectional committees for each of your disciplines. And then there are the young members committee. There are so many things that you can get involved in, the JI guy. So please don't think of this ISL as only being to get your charter and then vanish from the face of the earth. Get involved because we need people like you all to get involved and to help the, because some of us are, I mean, our thinking is going back years. So we need people with fresh thinking, new thinking to come and, you know, come with new ideas, how to do things. Any questions on CPD? And the last clause is about environment, sustainability. Basically, your whole engineering, your work revolves around protecting the environment. You don't try to do something that will damage, cause damage to the environment, whether it will be emissions or discharges or whatever it is. You have to avoid any adverse environmental impact and take the necessary mitigatory measures to minimize them. Become aware, learn the environmental regulations. The CEA has regulations, and learn what those are, and see that those are used by you in your various project work, especially where sites are involved or in the factory. This is again the same thing, you know, how you can apply new technologies. If you apply new technologies, what is the environmental impact that will have, and do you need to do any additional mitigatory measures to safeguard the environment? Then always try to reuse what you know, rather than just dumping stuff. I know you can't always do that, but wherever possible, try to reuse, especially containers and things which come in, people just throw away to the waste bin. But try and reuse and do it safe. Now I think there is a, I don't know how, it's not very strong in Sri Lanka, though. Things like fluorescent tubes, batteries, you know, people just dump those into the garbage. But technically you are supposed to take those, and there are special collection areas where these are supposed to be taken and treated and disposed of safely. I don't think it's very strong in the country, because we at various times people say that they are having some initiative to and they collect fluorescent tubes or bulbs or the CFL bulbs or anything, but at the end of the day you find it thrown into some waste bin somewhere, and that's the end of the, and it tends to pollute. As it gets broken, it tends to pollute. Conservation, again, this is something that at least everybody can practice. Save on electricity, save on fuel, and as far as possible try to minimize the use of a resource that is fast dwindling. And with this really comes the opportunity to look at renewable use of renewable energies. Okay, any questions on the environment in relation to the Code of Ethics? Okay, so now we have gone through the eight clauses of the Code of Ethics. I trust that you know everything that you need to know about the Code of Ethics, and that you may successfully answer the paper when it comes around. Frankly, there's no magic in this. It's all practical stuff. It's down to earth stuff, right? You know what it is. So I think, and what you need to know is what each clause is about. Right? And just make it easy. The first one deals with people. The first, where you look after the interests of the community, people. The second one upholds the honor of the profession. The third one is to achieve, and once you know uphold honor profession, you know what you have to write about.
Right.
There's no magic, there's nothing, no mantra required to know that. Then the third one talks of building your reputation on your own achievements. Then only you practice in areas of your specialization. Be loyal to your employee, be truthful in reporting, be involved in lifelong learning, and ensure that you practice environmental sustainability. So, so I just coined a little acronym for this, which helped me to remember them, which is PPASLPLE, which sounds like garbage to you anyhow, but basically you think of a past pupils association of your school, whatever it is, a PPA, and then the Sri Lanka Transport and Logistics Engineers. If you are doing logistics or transport, at least that can be a yeah, so that is it. Now, are there any questions you want to ask on the code of ethics? On the 8 clauses that you have had so far?
Everybody is fine. Everybody is happy. Anybody wants to go home, I think. Okay, so
that's not it. I've got a little more to talk about, but anyhow. Well, I don't know if you're familiar with this Calvin and Hobbes being something, the Sunday Times. And this small guy, he has a stuffed toy, a tiger, which he sort of makes believe is a real tiger and his companion. So they are walking and when they come to some muddy area, this guy suddenly pushes him. Then he says, why do you do that? Because he says the ends justify the means, that you can do anything wrong as long as you have a reason for doing it for your benefit. So the tiger says, I pushed him because the ends justify the means, you are in my way. So he says, that's not for me. You know, it can apply to everybody else, but not for me. So I am exempt from all the the ethical clauses won't apply to me, but it will only apply to everybody else. So that's professional conduct is. I'll run through disciplinary procedures because that is also an important thing that you need to know. Because the whole purpose of this code of ethics is that if you do something wrong, what do you do about it? What are you going to do about it? So the ISL came up with a disciplinary procedure. This is not a legally bound disciplinary process, but it basically gives ISL a way of taking some action against somebody who were to violate the code of ethics. So if any member is involved in any misconduct, then an ISL member has to write to the president of the ISL saying that so and so has done this wrong and making an allegation about what he did. Right. This is all in the bylaws, so you don't need to copy this. I think you just go and read the bylaws and you know, the code of ethics, everything is on the web now. I think you can go through I would suggest you go and go over the code of ethics again because it's not. Then the president, he has got this letter now, and then he will, with the vice president, with the president-elect, will decide on whether the member, yeah, and then he is also given, then if I get a letter against somebody, the secretary will write to the person and ask him to say, we have got this complaint, what do you say? So he will send a reply, like 2 weeks or 3 weeks or whatever. And then the president will look at what he has witnessed, decide is there a justification in proceeding with allegation, with the claim, with the process of, or has he vindicated himself, has he cleared his name? If the member is unable to vindicate himself, then the issue is referred to a disciplinary committee. Now, at the first council meeting, that's at the beginning of the in October after the AGM, the council meets for the first time, and at that meeting, the council will appoint 6 senior members, fellows most of the time, who will form this disciplinary committee. And out of the district committee, any 3 can be called upon to form a panel. So you have 6 people, of which any 3 can be taken to. So the council will nominate a panel to investigate this person's misdemeanor. And the council will fix the terms of reference for that committee. And they will nominate a chairperson, generally would be a retired president. Past president of the ISL. Now, the secretary would write to that person who will be who said, okay, these are the charges that have been put against you, that you have not indicated yourself. And they will give the names of these 3 people. And he is prepared to respond to that. Now, we send, why do you think we send the names? To the person accused. Why should ISL send the names of the 3 panel members? This guy, if he is nasty, he can go and bump them off in the over the weekend and they are going to be a panel. The purpose of this is because we don't want to have any prejudice. You see, now, these are engineers, this man is an engineer. He may have worked under one of these people who is in the panel. That person may or may not have liked him. So, to avoid, and then, so they avoid any sort of miscarriage of justice in a sense, you give the man the option of saying, I don't want this person in the panel. So he has a right to reply back and say, I agree to the other 2 members, but I do not agree to member to C, because C, I worked under C and I had a problem with him, and I feel that he might be biased. So the council will then decide to put from the balance 3, they'll put another man in and again write and ask him. Hopefully he will not throw that guy out, otherwise he will here go through this process, and when we exhaust all 6 people, then we are stuck. But generally, it never happens that way. Generally, if at all, one person gets replaced, but that's about it. And then you fix a date and time for the plan for the inquiry. So the executive secretary acts as the prosecuting counsel. He or she will present the case against the member. And the person who against whom the allegation is made can. We don't encourage being an outside lawyer, but he can get a senior member, a corporate member to represent him, or he can conduct his own defense. Now we have more and more engineers doing law, mainly in arbitration, but still they have some legal background, so sometimes I find one of those guys ending up here as the defense counsel. And basically we don't drag on with this, we try to finish it off as fast as possible. And within a month, finish off. And of course, all the documentary evidence, all the witnesses can be called, and it's like a legal, legal battle. Everybody is called in, and the disciplinary committee must be sure of whatever decision they take. So the disciplinary committee will send its findings to the president, and the president will put it to council. And the punishments can go, generally we don't go too far, but can end up with expulsion from the institution. It can end up with expulsion from the institution. And they say the council can direct that such a member is so far, I don't know, I don't think they've ever asked anybody to pay anything.
let's go ahead and do it. But if you are going to expel a person, there must be, I think, 2/3 of the membership of the council must be present at that council meeting. If you are going to dismiss the member from the membership. The person can appeal in writing again within 1 month, and they will, the council will refer that back to the disciplinary committee again for their observation, and after that the thing closes one way or the other. So what you have to be, this doesn't happen very often, is people saying, but you know, when your names are put up for corporate membership, it's circulated to all the corporate members. And that is a time when people remember something that you have done when you were a, you know, junior engineer somewhere, and they will write you. When I was secretary, we had a situation where the architecture sees that person. Hello, sir. Yeah, I'm fine. I'm not digesting. This person had been working with this professor, senior lecturer, had been doing his some research work involving hydrographic measurements of levels in different tanks in the North Central Corporation. And this guy, as an undergrad, just passed out. The instructor was hired by do this work. So he happily went and got all the information and the project did come. But in the meantime, one day this lecturer had gone to the site, that is, already dismantled the site to get the reading. So the lecturer decided when he to the farmer, the quite happy, and he said that the daily load of water, so he heard it about 500 rupees for the big Chinese donation. But they said, And he had beat up a small fairly good mistake. So anyway, the lecture, by the time this guy left the university and gone somewhere, and then when his name came up for circulation, this lecturer wrote him, saying this friend did this. And so we called this guy, and he came and denied him. And he said, look, this person has evidence because the farmers have all given this position saying that you have only paid him 250 bucks. So these are the receipts that you have given them for 250 rupees. So then he broke down and said, yeah, this time I made this money that I want to buy motorcycles in my bike because so anyway, big story. So anyhow, technically that was short, and he could have been, he thought, you know, it's not fair to doing a man's career straight away. So we, you know, gave a severe warning and said, okay, we defer your charge for 2 years. He has passed everything away, everything has been done. So we said, for 2 years, we will defer your charter, and then after 2 years, we will get your charter, unless somebody makes another complaint. So that's the time that most of these complaints come in. Quite often, there are no substance in the complaint, case of what people have been asking. But there are one of the cases which are very dear and have to be investigated, and you know, can be so be careful. You know, you get circulated to the corporate membership, you are, it's the most vulnerable time. Okay, so that basically I think ends up this session. If you have any question you want to ask me or anything, feel free to contact me. You can either get my email from Sanjeev or Nikhil or my
contact number. My argue my mobile number is 0712. But it's better if you, have an issue with email, because it's easy, then I keep the email to respond also on email rather than sending the number to email. Okay, so anyhow, good luck.